Good evening. Today's lecture we are going to devote on this topic, political obligation, right to resistance and civil disobedience. In fact, political obligation is a very important theme in political theory, because the question which is posed in this theme is that why are we obliged to obey the state and the law? And it is a very important question, because after all, the relationship between law, authority and the state on the one hand, and the people, the citizens on the other, is a very complex one, and there are a number of issues involved in this relationship. But after all, any political authority, any political system basically functions and survives on basis of the obedience of their law by the citizens. So therefore, how this obedience is secured, why people feel obliged to obey the rule of the state, that is the central question in this theme that is called political obligation. So therefore, the first important issue which comes up is, what is political obligation? In fact, if we run our eyes on the whole history of Western political thought, as well as Eastern political thought, including India, we find that this issue of political obligation has always been central to the engagement of political thinkers with the question of power, authority, legitimacy and the state. So therefore, it is a very important theme in political science as a whole, and in political theory in particular. Now, therefore, in fact, if we have to define this issue, that is, what is political obligation, we will have to take it as a duty and obligation to obey the state and the law, because after all, it is this, it is the law of the state which is enforced through number of means and mechanisms in society, and the people's obedience or people's acceptance is also secured, and that's why sometimes such action is called legitimate, particularly in the eyes of the people. So this is how we have to look at this question of political obligation, that obligation on the people of obligation on the people to obey the rule of the state. Now, but there are many questions which come up when we take up this issue of political obligation. First of all, the question which is often asked is that, why should we have a state at all? In fact, and the related question also comes up, that why should we accept the authority? Because there is a school of thought, not one, but there are several schools of thought which argue hypothetically that human beings could live a better and more meaningful life in the absence of the state and its authority. We will come to this issue. In fact, there is one school of thought which is known as anarchism, which is basically the the most powerful advocate of this line of thinking, that the state is unnecessary evil. It is evil as well as unnecessary, unlike liberals, who also believe or also call it an evil, but they say it is a a necessary evil. But for anarchists, it is unnecessary evil. So therefore, the questions which are often asked by a group of thinkers, by scholars, that in a hypothetical situation, they imagine that if there would be no state, would human life would be more meaningless, or human life will become more chaotic, more orderless? So therefore, is it mandatory for the meaningful life of people that a state should be there? Then related question, as I mentioned, also comes up, that why should we accept the authority of the state? In fact, what is so obligatory on us to obey the rule? For example, if you don't obey it, what will happen? So these are the questions which often come up in this discussion of political obligation. And what we find, that the normative questions about political authority and obligations are twofold. The first one is that, what we should do, particularly in relation to authority, in relation to legitimate power. and number two, that what principle we should follow, particularly in obeying or discharging our duty or offering our, you know, obedience to the authority in the law. So, therefore, these two normative questions, but along with this normative questions, there are also some descriptive questions, descriptive issues. For example, the justification for political authority and obligation are basically, you know, discussed as if there are normative principles and there are descriptive issues. And for example, you know, both normative and descriptive issues together, you know, put us in a situation where we can engage with this theme, this issue in a more holistic perspective. For example, that there are normative principles and there are descriptive issues like how world would be without it, without the state, because we know that there are many historical accounts in which, imaginary accounts one can say, in which history is imagined in a manner where there was a time when human beings, you know, lived in a stateless society, there was no state. Even today we can have, you know, some idea that how there are many, you know, tribal societies which do not have the kind of authority which normally we associate with the state. They have the system of authority, they have the system of law, but it is a customary law, it is a traditional law, not the kind of positive laws through which are which we are governed today within the broad nomenclature called state and, you know, authority. So, therefore, in fact, such questions are asked. And one can say that they are descriptive issues, for example, that how a world would be without it, that is without the state. Similarly, we also find that these normative principles and descriptive issues are basically, you know, are standing on certain premises. For example, one such premises is that obeying a state and law is the best thing to follow, normative principles we identify. But at the same time, they also give examples, or some examples can be cited. For example, that if we do not obey law, then society will collapse and there will be chaos. And therefore, the inference which is drawn that it is basically in our own interest to obey the law, obey the authority and offer political obligation in order to prevent the chaos to prevail. Similarly, you know, for example, such premise which I just now mentioned, that if you do not obey the law, there will be collapse of society and there will be chaos. But such argument or such, you know, premise can have two, you know, other related premises, one normative and another descriptive. For example, the normative premise which flows from this argument would be like this, that we have a duty not to allow society to collapse into chaos. Is a normative question. And when I talk of normative questions, it basically implies questions of norms, question of values, basically something which is desirable, something which is, you know, to be, you know, thought of. So, therefore, these normative questions pertain to the question of norms, and you, as we know that societies are basically, societies function to a great extent through norms which are created through, you know, interaction, through exchanges among people themselves. So, therefore, one such normative premise is that we have a duty not to allow society to collapse into chaos, because, you know, as a human beings we cannot live in chaos, and therefore, not obeying the law would result into chaos, therefore, it is our the duty to obey the law and authority. But at the same time, there is also descriptive premise existing along with this, and that descriptive premise is that if we do not obey the law, society will collapse into chaos. So, in fact, the difference is quite thin, but also very much there to see. First of all, that we have a duty not to allow society to collapse. That is something, it is a self-imposed righteousness, or one can say the self-imposed duty on us to not allow it to collapse. On the other hand, the descriptive premise is that if we do not do it, then it is essentially going to collapse. Now, what happens that in such situation, we find that these two type of arguments which are offered, one is moral, another is practical. Moral is something which is normative, as I mentioned earlier, and another is practical, that it is something related to means end, that if you don't do this, then it will result into this situation. But conclusion of these two premises are very simple to draw. The conclusions are that we have a duty to obey the law of the state, but you know, in order to challenge you know this, people have to either question the normative premise or the descriptive premise, because these two conclusions or one can say the conclusions which flow from these two premises, preceding premises which I just now mentioned, you know, is very simple, and the conclusion is that we have a bounden duty to obey the law. But in order to challenge this conclusion that you know we don't have any duty to obey the law, therefore we are free to disobey it, we are free to you know offer civil disobedience, because you know the title of today's discussion, which will be spread in two parts, is political obligation, theory of resistance and civil disobedience, because two things are part of the same coin, of course are two different sides of the story. One is the political obligation, that it is basically obligatory on us to obey the law. Another thing is that not only obey the law, but when the you know when the situation demands, it is also our duty to disobey it, to resist it, and to offer civil disobedience. So there are theories, there are thinkers on both sides of the discussion, on political obligation as well as on resistance and civil disobedience. In fact, Gandhi, which is one of the great thinker of civil disobedience and resistance. So we have to look at those ideas, those theories, and those you know thinkings also. For example, Gandhi, Thoreau, and other who are the thinkers of civil disobedience, along with some anarchists who totally disagree with this premise that it is our duty to obey the law. So therefore, this is how we have to approach this discussion: political obligation, resistance and civil disobedience. Today's lecture will be essentially on political obligation. The next part will be taking up this issue of resistance and civil disobedience. So let us go back to what we are discussing. So these are the premises on which you know the entire discussion is basically centered, so far as this issue of political obligation is concerned. And then one normative and another descriptive premises are offered, and from that a conclusion is also derived. And the conclusion, as I mentioned, is very simple, that we have a bounden duty to obey the law. But if someone has to challenge this conclusion, that this is not the case, that it is obligatory on us to obey the law, because if it is going to result into chaos, you know, how do you know that it is going to result into chaos? Can't there be a society which is self-governing? Can't there be a society without authority and law? Can't there be society where you have a local, you know, arrangement through which people govern their lives? For example, without, you know, a state authority, without the coercive apparatus of the state. This is how perhaps anarchist school of thought imagines the future society. Their utopia is basically based on such premises. So therefore, one thing we should remember, that if someone has to challenge this conclusion that we have a duty to obey the law, otherwise we will land up in a situation where there will be chaos and it will be counterproductive and detrimental for our life. So, but in order to challenge this conclusion, you have to question both the normative premise as well as descriptive premise. Then only perhaps you can take the discussion to its logical end. For example, you know, they may ask a question, those who are keen to challenge this premise as well as the conclusion which flows from this premise, that they may ask a question, you know, that is a normative you know question, or one can say normative challenge to a normative premise, that do we really have a duty not to let society collapse? Where from you know this thing is coming? Why should we take it on our shoulder, this responsibility, that will not allow the society to collapse? This is self-imposed morality, or one can say self-imposed moral duty, and therefore you know why to have this situation. Number two, that why do we believe that we have a duty? Where from this duty has come? Have we given anything in writing, or is it something which is basically ingrained in our nature? So, all these issues, normative issues, are raised as a challenge to this normative premise. But at the same time, the descriptive, you know, questions or the issues which we discussed, you know, along with the normative issues and premise, particularly in support or one can say as a justification for political obligation. Similarly, the retort, the questioning, the challenge to political obligation on, you know, on this descriptive, you know, front also, you know, comes up. For example, that why society will collapse if I do not obey the law? Where, what is the guarantee that if you disobey the law, the society will collapse? In fact, society may survive, society may function in spite of our disobedience. So, that is another, you know, questioning. Number two, are there not other ways in which we can prevent the society from collapsing other than obeying the law? Is there any other alternative? So, here the question comes of possibilities, options, exploring avenues through which, you know, this collapsing of society can be prevented. Even if we disobey the law, we can still not allow the society to collapse. So, therefore, the normative and descriptive premises get both normative and descriptive challenges, particularly in order to take this entire debate further. And the number three, that, you know, particularly this descriptive, you know, challenge also has the third dimension, that is, might we not set up, you know, as an example, they would say that might we not set up the anarchist self-governing federation, where we do not have that defined authority system the way we associate with the state authority. But in fact, after looking at these premises and the challenges which are there in the larger discourse on this issue of political, you know, obligation, we find that there are compelling arguments in favor of the duty to obey law, political obligation. It is not that challenges are not there. It is not that they are less, you know, powerful, they are less convincing. But on the whole, what we find that in political theory, you know, the arguments which are often offered in support of political obligation have been very compelling, not from today, but from, you know, from time immemorial, since the days of the Greek thinkers, Plato, since the days of, you know, the ancient Indian political thinking. So, therefore, whether we look at the West or the East, in fact, the political theory, political thought are replete with instances where thinkers have engaged with this political obligation issue, and they have given a very persuasive arguments in support of political obligation. So, therefore, in fact, this discussion or this background, you know, takes us to the larger issue of arguments in support of political obligation, because right now I have tried to give the both sides of the argument for political political obligation and the arguments against political obligation. And this against, you know, aspect will come up later in our discussion, maybe in the second part, particularly the theory of resistance and the theory of civil disobedience. But today's part is essentially focused on this issue of political obligation. So, therefore, what we find that this initial discussion takes us to the questions of arguments for political obligation. There are many schools of thought which have looked at this issue of political obligation. In fact, C.L. Wepper, a very, you know, author of a very interesting book on Western political thought. In fact, he, you know, makes a very perceptive statement. He says that why do you obey the state? And it is, this question is a running theme in the history of political thought. You look at any thinker, you look at any school of thought, you will find this query, persistent query, you know, coming off and on in the discussion, because it is the running theme. Now, C.L. Wepper, you know, of course, has his own way of dividing this discussion on political obligation, particularly, you know, among thinkers, and that categorization I will mention shortly. But, you know, if we look at the theories of political obligation, you know, there are different theories and different schools of thought, and some of those theories can be identified. particularly on the issue of political obligation. The first important theory is the consent theory, and this consent theory is normally associated with the social contractualists, particularly thinkers like in modern times Hobbes, Locke and Rousseau. The two of them belong to 17th century and Rousseau belonged to the 18th century. So, this the architect of modern liberal theory, one can say the architect of liberalism, particularly Locke and also to get extent Hobbes, the way they brought in the question of consent for authority, that without consent no authority, no legitimacy, and without consent no rule is possible, and therefore this is called consent theory. But at the same time they also base the entire argument for political obligation on the consent of the people. This is how they bring in the question of contract. This entire argument is basically posited in the framework of contract among people themselves for Hobbes, but in Locke there are two contracts, one among people, another between the people on the one hand and the representative of the government on the other. And therefore, there is a difference in the nature of contract in Hobbes and Locke. In Hobbes, that contract leads to a situation whether either you have a monarchy or anarchy. In fact, if you draw the consent, if you go out of the contract, if you violate the terms of the contract, if you refuse to obey the law and authority after entering into the contract, then that would eventually lead to chaos and therefore there will be anarchy and therefore the entire meaning of freedom will be lost. So, this is how the law looks at the social contract theory of the state, the origin of the state. And on the other hand, for Locke, it is basically it is framed differently. In fact, the first contract is among people and the second contract is between the people and the in the representative of the government. So, therefore, what happened that Locke retains, or one can say that gives the right to revolt and rebel to the people, particularly the second contract is with the government, and therefore, if the government violates the terms of the contract, then of course, people are free to disobey the law, people are free to revolt, people are free to rebel, and therefore, what happens that, that there is no chance of dissolution of the state, there is no chance of the dissolution of the government, only there is a chance of dissolution of the government. So, basically this entire possibility of chaos is basically ruled out in the Lockean theory of consent and contract, so far as political obligation is concerned. But so far as Hobbes is concerned, this consent is total, the contract is basically irrevocable and it can be revoked, but only the possibility of a chaos prevailing in society is very much there. So, this is the consent theory. In fact, if time permits, I will get back, I will go back to this issue later. The second theory, so far as the political obligation is concerned, is the organic theory. And this organic theory is normally associated with the idealist thinkers, be it the ancient Greek thinker like Plato or the modern thinkers like Hegel, Hegel, Green, Bradley, Bosanquet and many other European thinkers. These are the organic thinkers and the theory, particularly the organic theory believes or looks at the state in terms of an organ, the way one can look at the body. There are different parts which complete this body. Similarly, this state is also composed of different parts and therefore, they complete this whole. So, this is the argument of idealists that human beings are part of this organic whole and therefore, such questions that why do you obey the state, what is obligatory on us to obey the state, they say that is something like asking a question that why our hand should obey our body, because they are integral to body, such questions are nonsensical. So, therefore, this is how the organic theory looks at the question of political obligation. There are other theories, utility theory, there are coercive theory, there are minimalist theory, but these theories also are equally important. So, organic theory which is associated with the idealist thinkers looks at this argument on political obligation in the language of whole and parts, that the way body has different parts and those parts are integral to that body, and therefore the entire system functions through this harmonious relationship among parts in the whole. Similarly, the state and citizens are also tied in this organic form. The human beings are part of this organic whole, that is the state, and therefore asking a question that why do you obey the state, why should you obey the state, what will happen if you do not obey the state, have no meaning. These questions have no meaning because they are integral to it, and therefore like the hands cannot ask a question that why should we obey the direction given by the body, the mind. So, therefore, this is how the organic theory looks at it. Now, in fact, they are also critical of this consent theory. For example, Green, who was a very powerful advocate of this line of thinking, he often argued that it is a will, not force, which is the basis of a state. They were critical of any attempt to portray this state and the obligation to the authority in mechanical right, in mechanical light, as if it is a machine made by human beings and therefore they are free to obey or disobey as per their will, so as per their wishes. So, this is how the organic theory looks at the question of political obligation. In fact, for example, Hegel, the great proponent of this idealist school, he looked at the state as basically the actualization of freedom. Basically, the state was the ultimate evolution of this of this human entity, and therefore the freedom. So, therefore, he looked at that identity as sublimation of this entire identity of human beings into the state, and therefore realization of freedom. Now, after this organic theory, there is also utility theory, that is associated with utilitarians. Utilitarians like Bentham, look at it neither as as a consent, neither through consent theory nor through the organic theory, but they simply look at it from the point of view of utility, usefulness, that how useful state is for human beings. And as we know that for utilitarians, the scale is also given there. The scale is pleasure and pain. Whatever promotes pleasure and whatever diminishes pain is good for human society, good for human beings. So, therefore, this is purely the utilitarian calculus on basis of which they measure this issue of political obligation. And for them, the state is promoting human happiness, then of course people are obliged to obey the state. If it is not, then of course there is no obligation. So, it is a highly mechanical way to look at this question of political obligation, particularly from the point of view of utility. Then of course, you have a coercion theory, or one can say that theory which is associated with the communists and the anarchists, particularly Marx and Marxists and the anarchists. Some of them I mentioned earlier also, for example, Thoreau, Gandhi, Tolstoy, Ruskin and other, and many other thinkers who have looked at the state as basically as a sign of coercion. Basically, the state and state authority are nothing but are the sources of violence and therefore coercion, and therefore they feel that the sooner we get rid of it, the better. Human beings will be happier without the state and its law, because it is only resulting into more violence and coercion. It is only resulting into the diminishing, or one can say the reduction in the freedom of the people. So, therefore, they imagine a society, their utopia is based on a situation where there will be no authority, no law. In fact, they argue that authority and freedom cannot exist together. The sooner you get rid of it, the better. So, for the state is concerned, as I mentioned earlier also, they believe that it is an unnecessary evil. In fact, unlike liberals, about whom we will be talking later also, but you know, the consent theorists are also liberal, and they believe that of course there is nothing inherently good in the state authority, there is nothing inherently good in the law, but nonetheless it is a necessary evil, and that necessity is basically caused due to human nature, because human nature is as such that they need some external authority to manage and to govern them. Without some external authority, they cannot manage their own affairs. So therefore, this entire thing, both liberals and the anarchists have, you know, their arguments are premised on this human nature. Of course, the human nature painted into different frames. For anarchists, the human beings are by nature good. It is only the external intervention in their lives which basically disturbs their human nature, human character. They disturb their inherent balance and harmony, and therefore sooner we get rid of these external sources of intervention, it will be better for human freedom. And that is why they consider freedom and authority as basically detrimental to each other, particularly the relationship is quite adverse. But on the other hand, the liberals, unlike the anarchists, they believe that human nature is as such which requires such external regulation, external monitoring, and therefore their entire definition of politics is also basically fall out of such characterization or such portrayal of human nature. The best example is Machiavelli, who made a very interesting statement. He said that human beings are their nature is so bad that they can forget the murder of their father, but they can never forget the confiscation of their property. So therefore, this is how the human nature is painted by the liberals, and therefore they bring in this question of state law and authority and political obligation, that without some external source of authority or without any law and the state power, in fact there will be chaos. But anarchists have altogether different argument to offer. They argue that it is not the case. People can govern their lives, people can govern themselves better, even if we do not have the state and the authority. So therefore, these anarchist thinkers, be it Thoreau, Tolstoy or Gandhi, their utopia is a stateless utopia. For example, Gandhi talked about Ram Raj, the rule in which there will be no authority, people will be self-governing. Living in a self-governing societies, there will be Swaraj, that is not only the that will be a Swaraj in which people will have the complete control on their self, rule on their self. So we will basically come to these issues later. The next is of course the communist theory on political obligation. And it is also coercion theory like the anarchists. That is why what happens that some of the revolutionary picked up this the anarchist line of argument so far as the political obligation is concerned, be it Bakunin, Kropotkin and many other anarchist revolutionary theorists, Proudhon, many revolutionary theories who gradually shifted to this anarchist argument, line of argument. But the communist argument, one can say the communism, the way they look at the self-governing communes, they also talk about a stateless society. For example, Karl Marx talked about the withering away of the state, that there will be of course a society that is the communist society in which there will be no need of a state, therefore it will completely wither away. People will govern their own lives through their own means, particularly through number of mechanism. Of course, there is no clear-cut blueprint in Marxist thought and Marxist ideas that what will be the exact form through which these communist societies would be governed. Of course, there is a transitional stage of socialism in which Marx argued that there will be requirement of a state. When it came to Soviet Union after Bolshevik Revolution, Lenin also talked about such things, but in a different way. But as we know that Soviet Union, which basically after revolution tried to establish a communist regime, but initially they said that because of its transitional flux it was a socialist state and therefore a state was required. But as you know, the state gradually became so powerful that it was authoritarian in nature. So therefore, it remained only at theory so far as the withering away of the state is concerned, and it did not wither away, rather it became very strong. But so far as the political obligation is concerned, this coercive theory has two different advocates. One is from the communist, you know, school of thought, which includes Marxism as well, and another is the anarchist school of thought, which we have just now discussed. That brings us to the next school on political obligation, that is the minimalist theory, and it is associated with libertarians. They are also liberals like the consent theorists, but nonetheless there is a difference, and these libertarians particularly argue that the society does not require the state, and the most of them basically drawn that classical statement made by particularly Adam Smith, who said that there is a hidden hands of the market, and those hidden hands are more than enough to govern the society. So therefore, the state at most can only perform the role of a night watchman, nothing beyond this. These libertarians of the 20th century, late 20th century, like Nozick and others, have argued about a minimalist state, and therefore they have questioned this, this political obligation theory, which has argument for political obligation, which was given by different schools of thought, including the consent theory, organic theory, and utility theory. So these are some of the five important schools of thought one can identify on the question of political obligation. Now, C.L. Wapner, about whom I just mentioned earlier, that in his famous book on Western political thought, he says that this question, why do you obey the state, is a running theme in the entire corpus of ideas which we study as political thought. This Wapner also divide these arguments on political arguments in three forms. One is a state as organism, a state as machine, a state as class, and three of them fit into what we discussed just now under five theories. The fourth, of course, a state as coercion, which we also referred to, is not explicitly mentioned by Wapner, but one may add to his list, which seems to be quite interesting and quite exhaustive. Now, that brings us to the larger issue of the beginning of this question of political obligation. And as I mentioned, that Plato is a great idealist thinker, the Greek thinker of ancient period. In fact, Plato, though, remains the high priest of idealism, but nonetheless, so far as this consent theory is concerned, he seems to have laid the foundation of this consent theory, particularly in a given context. The context was the execution of his preceptor, his guru, Socrates, in the hands of the rulers of the day. Because Socrates, it was alleged that Socrates was basically polluting the minds of younger people in Athens through his revolutionary ideas, and therefore he was given a sentence of death. And Socrates, as it is well known, that refused to escape, he happily drank hemlock and preferred to die, because he thought that it was his duty to obey the law and order of the state. Therefore, this was the beginning of this argument of political obligation based on consent, which was basically taken to a great height by the contract theorists like Hobbes, Locke, and Rousseau. So therefore, idealists like Plato argue that asking a question that why do you obey the state is like asking a question as to why my hand should obey the body. That is basically a line of argument which all idealists would make. But what in fact they also mention that man gets its full fulfillment in the state, full realization. This is what organic model of society and a state is all about, be it Hegel, Grain, or anyone else, as we discussed earlier. But what happens that Plato also gave currency to this consent theory, particularly in his book Crito, written in 360 BC, as I mentioned. The Crito is basically based on this execution of Socrates, his guru, his his master, his preceptor. So therefore, this is the beginning of this consent theory of political obligation, and Plato's Crito is perhaps basically the trailblazer. Now, what happens that Plato's context, as I mentioned, was the Socrates execution, and his long stay in Athens, Socrates believed that his long stay in Athens constituted an agreement to obey the law, and by staying, he not only consented to obey the law, but for that he had to sacrifice his life as well. This was the Socrates interpretation of political obligation, and Plato in Crito, gives his endorsement of theory of political obligation, particularly as advocated by Socrates. Now, of course, about the consent theory, we have already discussed a little bit in context of the different schools of thought, Hobbes, Locke and Rousseau. In fact, the consent theory has two important claims to make. Number one, that by consenting, we have self-imposed obligation to obey. And number two, we have consented to obey. So, first is the self-imposed obligation to obey, and number is that we have consented to obey. But the second, that we have consented to obey, this premise has resulted into great debate in political theory. The number one question which flows from this premise that we have consented to obey is that how did we consent? Did we sign some bond? Did we enter into some written contract? What is the proof that we have consented to obey? And number two, to whom we consented? Who was the person who was securing this consent from us? So, therefore, this consent theory has certain premises, and those premises are problematic and have generated a lot of controversies and a lot of debate. It is argued that except the new immigrants in the society, no one else gives consent in writing, or no one enters into such a type of arrangement where he has or she has consented to obey the law. So, therefore, this entire premise is not without controversy and questioning. The theory talks of tacit, but one thing is interesting that this consent theory talks about two types of consent, the tacit consent and the express consent. The tacit consent is the consent by omission. For example, in a democratic order, we go and vote. Voting is basically a tacit consent that we have consented to avail the right to vote, but at the same time also we have consented to obey all the orders of the state. Number two, residing in a particular geographical area and not moving out of it, availing the benefits which are basically accruing to me on basis of my residence in a particular geographical area is also a tacit consent given to the authority. Therefore, it's a basically quid pro quo. We are availing of certain benefits, and therefore we have tacitly consented to obey the law. So, this is basically the tacit consent. Then they also talk of express or active consent. For example, the active consent is of different type. For example, it is different from, it is active, not passive, when you basically give consent for something. Now, what happens Plato and Locke advocates of this consent theory, they would argue that residing in a particular area is a tacit consent, but Hume, a Scottish philosopher thinker of modern time, he argued against it. He thought that it is like presence on the board of a ship of a man who was carried while asleep. This argument resembles with that situation if someone was taken on a ship when he was sleeping, he didn't know, he was not aware of he's being carried on the ship, and then one can say that he was on the ship through his consent. It is something like this. So, therefore, he is totally dismissive of this tacit consent. Rousseau, another the contract theorist, his argument was that when a state does not impede our exit, then our continued residence is to count as effective consent. So, these are some of the arguments for the consent, both tacit and express. But what happens, those who critique it, they argue that what happens when we face a coercive state, when we don't have any freedom, does it mean also consent? For example, if it is not a democratic order and we are participating in election, we are residing in a particular geographical area, still it can be constituted as a tacit consent, because here the main force behind the law is coercion, not consent. So therefore, there are many issues involved with this consent theory, be it tacit or express. In fact, Plemenos, one of leading political theorists on particularly this issue of voting as a consent, he says that if voting is free and voluntary, then only one can say consent. It is a consent. But if it is forced, it is not voluntary. Then how is it possible to call it a consent? Of course, along with this tacit and express consent, there is also notion of hypothetical consent. And here, basically, Hobbes's arguments are often referred to, because his entire argument in social contract theory was hypothetical in nature, that what would happen, in a situation where there would be no state, no authority in law. But there are critics of this hypothetical consent as well. Dworkin, one of the leading philosopher of contemporary times, Dworkin says that hypothetical contract is no contract, and therefore, this has no meaning. But the answer is the rational and self-seeking. Basically, for those critics who dismiss this hypothetical contract of Hobbes, the defender of this hypothetical contract, or the followers of Hobbes, or admirers of Hobbes, or supporters of this line of thinking would argue that the basis for this hypothetical contract is rational and self-seeking, which was the argument of Hobbes, that it was rational to preserve life, because life preservation was the main driving force behind this contract mentioned in Hobbes, and self-seeking, it was the interest of the people to adhere to political obligation. It was not for others, it was for their own benefit, in their own interest, that without political obligation, there was chances of chaos, there were chances of loss of freedom. Therefore, the people, it was a driving force behind political obligation. Now, therefore, what we find that, these are the different arguments we can see on this issue of political obligation coming from the consent school of thought. Next comes utilitarians. And here I mentioned Bentham, who is basically known for this pleasure-pain calculus. In fact, for Bentham, the state is beneficial because it gives us road, it gives us police protection, it gives us hospital, it gives us education, and therefore these are the justification for political obligation. So ultimately it is useful and it is in our interest. If it does not promote our pleasure and does not diminish our pain, then there is no basis for political obligation. So this entire obligation is not anchored in any moral terms, rather purely looked at from the point of self-interest. Therefore, the critics also point out, so far as the utilitarian theory is concerned, that those who want to reap the benefits of others' obedience without paying the cost will not regard it as obligation. So therefore, there are a number of criticisms of utilitarian theory these days. One of the powerful critics has come from John Rawls, particularly those who advocate the rights and justice. They believe that this utilitarian argument for political obligation has no meaning, no basis. For example, punishing an innocent person to deter the future criminals, that if, even if you know that the person is not criminal, but still you punish him, because you feel that that even if you are punishing an innocent person, but it will deter the future criminals, deterrence theory of punishment, then, as for utilitarian theory, it may be just, but otherwise from the point of view of rights and justice, it is totally unjust and immoral. So therefore, utilitarian theory has been taken to task by those who, adhere to this rights and justice discourse. And therefore, these days, it has been subjected to rigorous criticism. About the communists, we have already discussed the Marxist idea, particularly in terms of the class basis of the state, because how the state has, how state has originated. And there is a very well-known Marxist theory of the origin of state, particularly on basis of historical materialism, that how human beings started their journey from primitive communism and then gradually moved towards slavery, to feudalism, to capitalism. So, this historical evolution and how the class division took place in society and how the class divisions ultimately resulted into the state power. So, a state is basically product of this class division. So, therefore, this is nothing but the reflection of the class material basis of the society in the class divisions, and therefore, there is nothing moral associated with the state authority, and therefore, it is nothing but coercion. Marx went to the extent of saying that a state is nothing but the managing committee of the bourgeoisie, and therefore, the revolution had a task to basically dismantle this state authority. It has no legitimacy. Whatever power and authority the state enjoys, it is only because of coercion and the coercive apparatus which is at its command. So, this is how the communists have looked at it. Libertarians, Nozick, as I mentioned in his book Anarchy, State and Utopia in 1974, where he made a powerful plea for the free market, drawing on the classical liberals like Adam Smith and Ricardo, he also believed that this political obligation, or one can say that whatever argument is offered in support of law and authority, they are not good for human freedom. And therefore, whatever law is to be there, it is only to defend the right to property. Otherwise, people should be left to themselves. The anarchists, of course, and their argument, completely, merges with this entire theory of resistance and civil disobedience. So, therefore, anarchism and their argument that a state is unnecessary evil, there is no moral duty to obey the law, there is no moral duty to obey the state, and the entire argument for resistance is basically something which is very important if you have to complete this entire discourse on political obligation. So, therefore, the next part of our discussion will be essentially focusing on this issue of theory of resistance and civil disobedience, and there we will look at particularly the anarchist school of thought along with the new argument for global justice, and particularly on civil disobedience we will have a special focus on Thoreau and Gandhi, the two important theorists of civil disobedience. So, this is how we have to look at this question of political obligation, theory of resistance and civil disobedience.